Good evening. Welcome to St. Mark Church. Today is the second Sunday in ordinary time. Through baptism, we have been joined to the Lord who calls us to be his disciples. Let us prepare our hearts to hear his voice and give a faithful answer. This Mass is being offered for the well-being of Joseph Williams and family. And our celebrant is Father Michael. And out of reverence for sacred worship, please silence your cell phones each. Thank you. And let us stand now for our celebration.
Now, sing to your name and all those quiet.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare to celebrate the sacred mysteries. Lord Jesus, you perform miracles for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you are the Lamb of God. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you make us holy in body and spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to people and of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty heavenly God, who govern all things, both in heaven and on earth, mercifully hear the pleadings of your people and bestow your peace on our times. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Gospel according to Samuel. Samuel was sleeping in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. The Lord called Samuel, who answered, "Here I am." Samuel ran to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." "I did not call you," Eli said. "Go back to sleep." So he went back to sleep. Again the Lord called Samuel, who rose and went to Eli. "Here I am," he said. "You called me." But Eli answered, "I did not call you, my son. Go back to sleep." At that time, Samuel was not familiar with the Lord because the Lord had not revealed anything to him yet. The Lord called Samuel again for the third time. Getting up and going to Eli, he said, "Here I am. You called me." And then Eli understood that the Lord was calling to you. So he said to Samuel, "Go to sleep, and if you are called, you would reply, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" When Samuel went to sleep in his place, the Lord came and revealed his presence. calling out as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel answered, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." Samuel grew up, and the Lord was with him, not permitting any word of his to be without effect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will.
Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will.
I have waited for the Lord, and he stooped towards me and heard my cry. And he put a new song in my mouth, a hymn to our God.
Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will.
Sacrifice or offering, you wish not. But ears open to obedience you gave me. Holocausts or sin offerings you sought not. Then I said, "Behold, I come. Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will." In the written scroll, it is prescribed for me to do your will, O my God, is my delight, and your law is in my heart. Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will. I announce your justice in the vast assembly. I did not restrain my lips, as you, O Lord, know. Here I am, Lord, I come to do your will. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, body is not for immorality, but for the Lord. And the Lord is for the body. God raised the Lord and will also raise us by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? But whoever is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Avoid immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body. But the immoral person sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you have been purchased at a price, thank God. Therefore, glorify God in your body. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
We have found the Messiah, Jesus Christ, who brings us truth and grace.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. John was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard what he said and followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following him and said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and you will see." So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they stayed with him that day. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, was one of the two who heard John and followed Jesus. He first found his own brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated Christ. Then he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You will be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Brothers and sisters of the Lord Jesus Christ, on the second Sunday in the ordinary time, all those three scriptures, passages, are inviting us to be committed to God and His ways. So a kind of invitation given to us through the scripture to reflect on our lives as our life and our identity as Christians, and then be committed to God's kingdom. In the first reading, we have a beautiful story of how Samuel, the prophet, was called by God. The very word Samuel means God hears. And we know why he called that name, because his mother Hannah was praying in the temple when she didn't have any children. She was worried. She was barren at that time, and she cried to the Lord in the temple. And it is the same high priest Eli who came and thought that she was a drunken woman, and then asked her to go home. She told him, "I'm not drunk. I'm pouring out myself before the Lord in prayer, for I do not have a child." In the words of the priest, "Go, the Lord will bless you." In a year's time, she gets the child. Firstborn male, and they named him Samuel because the very word means, the name means God hears. God has heard me. And now as he grows, you know, she finds it okay that the son should be offered for the temple service. So Samuel is brought back to the temple and offered Eli for ministering the Lord in the temple. Now the temple that we are speaking about is not the huge temple that Solomon built that comes later on in the history of the Jewish people. At this point in time, probably they had a small makeshift kind of a place where they had a chamber where they kept the Ark of the Covenant. Probably there was a little place for the priest to stay, because the scripture does mention that Eli was in this place. But since it probably was a smaller one and the boy was growing around the Ark of the Covenant, if you pay attention to the later part of the history of Jews, when the temple was built, nobody else can go close to the Ark of the Covenant except the high priest. But at this time, at this point of time, they don't have a huge temple with all four courtyards. They have a smaller place probably, so the boy stays next to the Ark of the Covenant in the same chamber. And it is time for the Lord to commit Samuel for the mission for which he chose. And therefore he speaks to him. He calls out his name four times. And the scripture is so clear that he must know. No, he heard someone calling him. He thought it was Eli, and therefore runs to Eli. But the fourth time, it is not only just calling. The scripture does say, when Samuel went to sleep in his place, the Lord came and revealed his presence. It's not just calling. The Lord completely revealing him, his holy presence to this person. Calling out as before, "Samuel, Samuel." Brothers and sisters, something similar. We reflected last Sunday about the baptism of the Lord. We also question our commitment as baptized Christians. The Father was pleased to announce to the world that this is my beloved Son. The Lord is also pleased to announce to the world at every baptism that the candidate being baptized is the Son, daughter of the Lord Himself. And therefore the Lord sets out our lives to make Himself available to the world. And the last line of the scripture does say, Samuel grew up and the Lord was with him, not permitting any word of his to be without effect. I would like to lead you back to last Sunday's reading, the first reading too, from the book of prophet Isaiah chapter 55. We did hear the Lord saying to us, just like the rain comes down makes everything fertile, my word that I send will come down and bear fruit and then will return to me. So here we have the scripture telling us, not permitting any word of his to be without effect. This first prophet, Samuel, was blessed in an abundance. And he had the privilege to anoint two great kings for Israel. King Saul, as well as King David. He was the spokesperson for the Lord. He spoke to the people in the name of the Lord. Such a great prophet was invited for the mission. Like him, we are also invited. Our baptismal commitment, promises, needs to be lived. In the second reading again, St. Paul, writing to the Corinthian community, Corinth is as a little port town. As a port town, it had a lot of booming economy. Along with money and prosperity comes a lot of other evil. And this community was so much given into immorality. And that is why, as Paul corrects them on various issues, he makes it a point to speak to them about their immoral ways. Life of impurity, of every kind that you can imagine. This message is not only for them, but for all of us. This world, today's time, is not an exception. It is corrupt in so many ways. Look at any direction. Impurity and unholiness has become the hallmark of this society. Immodesty, immoral ways are becoming the hallmark of this society. Our children are getting spoiled in so many ways. So this passage is another invitation to us in the words of Paul, that the Lord calls us to holiness and purity as members of Christ. And therefore our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. God gives us this body and God anoints our bodies by baptism, not to allow us to go into live a wild life, no. To live responsibly for God and His ways. And therefore we have a sacred obligation to put away all immorality and live as true temples of the Holy Spirit. I would like to get your attention on the last line of the second reading. Therefore, glorify God in your body. This is the invitation we get today. We have gathered here to witness God's goodness in the Eucharist. As we are sent out after the Mass, you and I are called to glorify the Lord by our lives. Glorify the Lord by our bodies, all that we do in our bodies. And again, the Gospel passage again is a powerful invitation to us as Jesus accepts two of his disciples, the two disciples of John the Baptist. And John pointed out to them, "Behold the Lamb of God." He pointed out to Jesus and "No, the Lamb of God." The word Lamb of God is not a simple title. It is scriptural, filled with meaning, theological meaning. Because the Lamb of God was used as the Lord provided salvation, liberation to the people of God in Egypt. And therefore, the future Lamb of God the Lord will send will be the source of redemption for all His people. So when John says to Jesus about Jesus, "Behold the Lamb of God," he doesn't just give a title. It comes with a lot of meaning for the Jewish nation. And therefore these two disciples are pointed out, here comes the Messiah, here comes the promised one, he is the anointed one. So what do? They leave John and go after Jesus. But the words that the disciples speak when Jesus is asking, "What are you looking for?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," you know, which is like a teacher, any teacher is called Rabbi. So they do not have at this point of time a true realization of who Jesus was. Therefore, Jesus leads them to a day's experience It takes them for a come and see experience. What do they see? Jesus doing miracles. What do they hear? Jesus proclaiming for the kingdom. So they saw Jesus in powerful in word and deed for a day. And now at the end of the day, what happens? They do not have a realization of Jesus as a rabbi. Much more than that. Therefore, we have Andrew going to his brother Simon and tells him, we have found the Messiah. No more a rabbi, no more a teacher, but the Messiah, the anointed one, we have found him. And they followed Jesus after from there. Every time we come for the Eucharist, Jesus invites us personally to have this come and see experience. We come here and witness what God can do. Transforming the body, transforming the bread and wine into his body and blood. Blessing us with peace and sending us out to make available to the world what we witness within the church. This come and see experience, God intends that by this experience we may grow his love and make his love available to one another. So like Samuel called for a greater mission, like the Corinthian community was invited to live holy and pure to glorify God through their lives. Like these two disciples were introduced to Jesus so that they can be great pillars of the church. You and I are called to bask in the holy presence of God at the Eucharist so that we can go out and witness the gospel. God has a special purpose by inviting us to his church today. And every time we come around here, he invites us to live our lives as true witnesses to the gospel. Let us ask him for the blessings. May he be with us. May he bless us, that we may in turn become blessings to everyone whom we encounter. May God bless us. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten and not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became a man. For our sake he was crucified and Pontius Pilate, and suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Brothers and sisters, let us present our petitions to our living God.
That those who lead our church may receive God's guidance and strength, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those suffering oppression throughout the world may experience the peace of Christ in their lands and in their lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who struggle with chronic physical ailments may grow strong under the gentle and nurturing hand of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Jesus' love may confirm us evermore to his own heart as we strive to follow him more closely. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the souls of the faithful departed may find eternal peace in God's presence. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, hear the prayers of your people who have been called to follow your Son. Answer them in your goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and
for
all his holy Church.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Amen. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without the end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dew fall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Alexander, our Archbishop, Peter, his assistant bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, St. Mark and St. Peter, our patrons, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be coerced to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and hope by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And your spirit.
Let's offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Precious is the chalice that
quenches
my thirst.
For those who cannot have received Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the Most Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Pour on us, O Lord, the spirit of your love and in your kindness. Make those you have nourished by this one heavenly bread, one in mind and heart. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a few announcements. The office will remain closed on Monday, January 18, in observance of Martin Luther King Day. And from coming week, we will not be having any sign-ups for Mass. We can accommodate 130 people for a Mass, but we hardly have half of it taken. The very reason that we have sign-ups to keep that number not crossing 130, but you know, about 50, 60 people, so I didn't think we need to have sign-ups done anymore, except for the Spanish Mass. The Spanish Mass gets filled. And the other Masses, both the St. Peter and St. Mark, we will not have sign-ups. So you can just come and then attend the Mass. If this number of people growing, then we may go with the directions of the archdiocese. So just keep that in mind. So for the time being, we will not have sign-ups for Mass. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Prayer to Saint Michael the Archangel.
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle, be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God and David be humbly prepared, and do thou the prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust us to the faith, and the evil spirits, who cry,